G'day and welcome to Xpress Lane, a podcast for small business owners and franchisors to better navigate the trials and tribulations of growing a successful company. It isn't easy, but the rewards are definitely worth it. So Xpress Lane is bringing you industry leaders who share their wisdom and give you support in kicking your small business goals this year. If you're experiencing rapid growth in your business right now and looking at where you can go from here, then you're not going to want to miss this one. I've got Tim Butters of City Cave fame with me today. Look, they spotted a trend that was on everyone's lips, which is the massive well-being benefits people experience when they use flotation tanks. Not only did they spot the trend, they've capitalised on it. So City Cave's been growing at a rapid rate since it commenced operations in 2016. So Tim, welcome to the call.
Great, thanks for having me, guys.
If you can just provide us a little bit of a background to yourself, the business, and how you got to where you are.
Yeah, cool, no worries. I guess I'll start off with what we were doing beforehand. So myself and my business partner, Jeremy, both come from the trade industry, so which is very, very different to wellness, as you can respect. I started out as a tiler and stonemason. I was given the opportunity to work on large-scale businesses and big homes, and I guess it was always incepted to me from my old apprenticeship days that I always desired more out of life, I guess. It's one of our core values is abundance. It's kind of like there's plenty out there, you just got to go and get it. Jeremy, my business partner, shares those values. He was a builder by trade. You know, we've both worked in the trade game for a good 10 to 15 years before we decided to make the move into retail. So we were importing products from China, and we had 8 retail stores around Brisbane, which is where our head office is today. And I guess that taught us a lot about customer service and growth in bricks and mortar style businesses. The only thing that didn't gel with us was we didn't want to die being the Manchester importer guys. We didn't want to be the guys that sold pillows their whole lives. And we had a few other restrictions around growth because we had a few other business partners and things like that. So we had the opportunity to sell that company to one of our suppliers, which we decided to take that opportunity and then pretty much just be unemployed while we decided which path we wanted to go down. From there, a friend told me about flotation therapy. And this is back in 2016, where flotation therapy wasn't really much of a thing back then. You know, there was a couple of operators in Brisbane, and it was really hard to try to find them and work out how to even make a booking, let alone go in there and make it a regular part of life.
Yeah, right.
Jeremy and I both, because we both weren't working, we were taking a little bit of a hiatus out since we had sold the last company, and we thought, look, let's really figure out what we want to do. Do we want to go back to the trade industry? Do we want to look for something new? And by no means did we think about having a flotation therapy business when we made the booking. A friend of ours just told us about this amazing concept where you're in this environment full of 400 kilos of Epsom salts, and it's sensory deprivation. It removes all external stimulus, so you can kind of focus on your thoughts and things like that. And we thought that sounded great for the transitional period we were going through in our lives. We found this little space down in Brisbane CBD and went in and gave it a go. And it was absolutely incredible. It was like a, I mean, I still look back at it and call it the business meeting with myself. It was like a meeting with just my thoughts, and it was a real focusing tool, which we still use to this day for that purpose. But Jeremy and I, we came out of this these little pods, sat on a couple of uncomfortable wooden chairs and sat down, kind of looked at each other and said, shit, man, this was incredible. We both looked at each other and said, this is our next business idea. We've got to do this, and we've got to do it better. So we decided to start researching and researching the industry, not just here in Australia, but looking at countries like America, where it is a way of life over there.
Yeah.
And decided, you know, created our point of differences and our value and all that kind of stuff, and then decided to move forward from there.
So how did you sort of research this sector? Because I've got a couple of takeaways here. You've obviously got a good appetite for risk, which I think is important for any small business owner or entrepreneur. You must have an appetite for risk. You've got a conceptual idea, essentially, that you've heard from a friend, and you've gone to a float tank here in Brisbane and then gone, wow, okay, so how do we find this information?
You touched on it at the beginning of this podcast. The wellness industry as a whole is massively growing. Like, we are in an amazing space where people are spending money on themselves through all different modalities. You know, the traditional way was a practitioner. It was an allied health professional that you'll go in and see, like a physio or chiro, which, and all of these things are super, super important. And then there's this gym and fitness style business that has just boomed over the past. And that wasn't really too much of a thing, you know, a good 50 years ago, or 50 plus years ago, the people that went to the gym were those circus freaks with these huge muscles walking around with people with paid to get tickets to John Watson. And nowadays, everybody and anybody in my network, they all have gym memberships, and it is just a way of life. And I think that there's this huge movement of mental health that we are dealing with at the moment, and people are looking for ways to escape the overstimulized life that we all live these days. And I guess our criteria that we were looking for, we were in a tiny niche. We had to try to balance out our strategy moving forward, going into an industry where there really isn't demand. I say there isn't demand. There isn't demand from a broad perspective where we are going into a market where we have lots of competitors, but we felt there was a demand and a need for what we have. Mm. And I think here in Australia, we are trendsetters, but we also follow on the coattails of what happens over in America and Europe as well from a broader industry perspective. And we really saw flotation therapy growing rapidly over there, and it still is. So we decided to make the move into this realm. But based off the fact that it was a fairly low financial point of entry for us,
right.
We had some capital ourselves. Good luck getting funding when you have an idea like, I want to create a flotation therapy business.
Well, that's right.
It's near impossible. And I you know, even friends and family, when you are starting out in small business, I really highly recommend getting challenged by friends and family, putting together your business plan and asking for as many opinions as possible. We didn't have many good ones back then, so we really were pioneering this this industry from day one, and we just really had a strong why and a strong belief that it was going to work based off the realization that we had from actually utilizing the service and deciding that everybody needs something like this in their life. People need another avenue other than a gym membership to look after their health. It's not just physical, it's mental there as well.
Oh, definitely. Look, and you've segued right into the funding question there, which is perfect. So how did you actually approach this? I mean, you said you had some startup capital yourself, but then you've obviously grown this and you are a growing and rapidly growing network. There's infrastructure involved. How have you approached that yourselves and essentially supported, I guess, your franchisees in doing that?
Honestly, James, this is a really good question because I think a lot of people get this wrong when they start out in business, and we did get it wrong. We thought that we had enough funding to do it. We found ourselves very undercapitalized going into, we overextended ourselves by opening a second location too quickly. We didn't have the financial aptitude to grow at the pace that we were growing at back then. And now we have a strong bunch of advisors around us now, great accountants. We've got a CFO, we've got an in-house accountant, we've got people that really help us manage our cash flow and that kind of thing. Essentially, we started out with cash and we thought we were going to be cash flow positive throughout the whole journey. And we hit some hard times where we did have to, you know, get into payment plans with the ATO and not pay ourselves for a good chunk of time, which has a huge, huge effect on your personal life as well. Yeah, I think that's a fundamentally really, really important part of starting a business is understanding your numbers.
Definitely. Look, and you've actually touched on something as well in here about building a team of advisors around you, trusted advisors and mentors. So you've got your professional services team there. Have you had any external mentors as well who maybe not as focused on the structural side, but just generally?
Yeah, good call. Massively. We wouldn't be here without those people, I think. Starting out in a business, if you've got a big appetite and you want to scale, you need people that have done it before to bounce ideas off and lean on them at your crossroads, because you will have many, many crossroads and lots of opportunities that are presented. So you need people to give you strong, sound advice. And there is no better person than people that have done it before. I was telling somebody the other day, I had an example about how that a conversation has lasted the test of time. So about 4 years ago, when we were in one of these situations where we were like, shit, we need to pay these bills, we don't have the funds, we need to try and pull capital from somewhere. And we sat down with one of our mentors and said, look, we're really stressed, we need to pull some cash together and we don't know where to pull it from. And, you know, we're at a bit of a hard financial crisis time. And he looked at us and said, yeah. And he's like, who do you think you are to not have financial stress in a company that's growing this way when you're a startup? You guys can't afford to have the right advisory council around you and things like that. And I was just saying to Jeremy, my business partner, yesterday, we've got a lot of things happening over in America at the moment with City Cave. We've got a site that we're opening in Florida, and it's taking a lot of time and energy to be working on that while still focused on the growth here in Australia. And I said to Jeremy, oh man, I wish that we had more time to just focus on America. And then I kind of pulled myself out of that and said, oh, who do I think I am? there's always the perfect scenario. And quite often, you need to strap the boots on and work crazy hard and work lots of hours and, I guess really analyze your next moves.
Yeah, very, very much so. Before you started, just to go back a little bit, because you have touched on something here as well around, it sort of links into a plan, I guess. What did your plan at the start look like compared to now? It's evolved, obviously, and what would you have included in that plan at the start that perhaps you've got now?
We didn't actually start out with the intention of franchising. We started out as a company owned site, which we started and we worked in it every day. We had no employees for the first, I think, 3 months. So Jeremy and I worked all of the 90 hours for the week with just the two of us. We then took a step into our second location in Paddington, which was a much bigger concept, which meant that we had to bring on quite a few staff. I think we hired five or so people to help with the old site, which was running autonomously. It was working really well. And then as soon as we started putting focus into the second location, the first one, which was our cash cow, started to decline because we weren't there every day. We weren't spending time with the customers. You know, when you've got skin in the game, the business has to work and you live it and breathe it. And obviously we're both passionate people about our brand. So that probably was relayed really clearly and easily to the customers. When we were taken out of that environment, we saw it decline. And then it made it really difficult to stretch our time across both locations and hiring the right people and then learning that next phase, that next lesson, which is growth and staff management instead of customer management.
Yeah, that's a really good point, Tim. I'm just going to jump in there because, it's so common across some of these discussions we have. There's time management you touched on earlier with your offshore growth, and I wish we had more time. You know, it's focusing on where the value is. You know, the cash cow was declining because you were looking at the new store and probably fairly so. And so to scale that to service the need and make sure you're focusing on the value, it's hiring the right people and taking that step. You made a decision you needed to do that. How did you actually go about it? And did you get it right the first time, or did you have a few learnings in the hiring process?
We had a whole bunch of learnings there, and I think coming from a construction background, we might have had a different management style than what somebody that was owning a City Cave and being that manager of people should be like. I always look for opportunities to just be better, and that was something that we identified where we needed to learn how to manage people in a nice, calming environment, people that are coming from hospitality or customer service in different areas. You know, with when you're running trades, so my construction company, I had 18 employees there, and those guys, you know, you can kind of get reasonably aggressive to get a result, and you drive a construction company completely different to how you drive a bricks and mortar City Cave center. I think most of our lessons were around just the fundamental, simple day-to-day management opportunities. We had managers, we were promoting people based off personality, not just skill set. We didn't have the right policies and procedures and training manuals in place. We were just kind of expecting people to kind of pick up and learn as the same way that we did. But our business was already starting to become fairly mature, and we should have had all of those proper HR platforms in place before we started hiring. We ended up starting to roll all of that so more compliance side of things out, probably more in year two, instead of you should do that before you even start hiring.
Yeah, no, it's a good point. And the business planning process at the start is so important, and obviously plans evolve and develop over time. But that HR and that resource onboarding plan is often sometimes overlooked, I think, because you said before, focusing on the customer. So what's our customer value proposition? That's really important. And then all of a sudden, oh, hang on, we've got to put some people in here, and how do we go about it? So that's an important point there for everybody to plan up front.
And I think this is why franchising is so great, is because you are, every time you open a new location, it is with somebody who's just as passionate as we were at the beginning. So it's kind of like, if you've got somebody that's a bit of a pillar of health for their community and for their internal team. And I mean that not just in the way of physical health, it's also like, you know, just that leader that's, you know, helping people with their personal finances and things like that. I think for us, it was a bit of a no-brainer to move in that direction.
So I'm going to change tact a little bit now. You and Jeremy are in a partnership, right? So we're talking about roles and responsibilities. It's often something that's really important for any business to ensure clear roles and responsibilities. But in a startup and in a smaller business, it can often be a bit muddied. How did you both decide who'd be responsible for the different aspects of the business?
Look, it took a while. It took quite a few confrontational crossovers, I could probably put it. We're lucky. We sponsor a professional boxer, so he gets us in the ring every week as well, so we can kind of let out our frustrations. No, not against him. But no, look, to be honest, it started out, you know, everybody said that you need to have your lanes, and it is really important. But at the beginning, when passion is fueling the business, you kind of want to have your eye over everything. And I think that probably for the first 12 months, we would just come together, and any decision that needed to be made in the company was made together. Quite often, one opinion over somebody else's, and everybody thinks they're right, especially between myself and Jeremy.
Yeah.
then after we'd been trading, we kind of moved naturally and organically into what we were kind of good at. And then we just identified it, and we work off a 90-10 rule now. We established that within our first year of trading, where it was with the things that I control, which is compliance, financial control, legal and accounting management, and Jeremy does marketing, brand development, and construction management. Those areas of the business, what I'm in control of 90% of it, and then I go in and I talk to, if I need to bounce something off him, he can put a 10% input in on something else. But at the end of the day, it's my decision on my side of the business and his decision on his side of the business. And I think that's a really healthy way to be in a partnership. I don't think that you can identify that straight away, but it's something, it's a goal that you want to establish fairly quickly. Otherwise, you'll end up having too many confrontational discussions.
Look, I think it's really good, actually. And I haven't really heard that one before. And I think it's good that everyone should adopt. Everybody has a voice in a partnership, but you need to leave people the space to do what it is they're supposed to do. Mm-hmm. So it's a good model. Let's throw this one out there. Do you have any tips for SMEs just starting out? Not just one piece of advice. I think there's already been some great advice through here today, but I'm sure you've got a number of tips you can pass on to the audience.
I'll just go back to the first point that I made before around costs. Make sure you get a really, really strong understanding of what you want to do, how much it's going to cost, and what would happen if it didn't go as well as you had planned. So understanding your numbers, that's one area that it's worth spending money on a strong advisor to help you build financial forecasts and those cash flow forecasts, which are king when you're working off the smell of an oily rag.
Yeah.
Know your business model inside and out. Opportunities arise when people come to you and ask you about your model. If you're 100% in and you know every nook and cranny of your business, that interests people to whether you're looking for capital in the future, when you're hiring staff in a startup, they want to know that you know the business model inside and out. And one thing that we learned late in the piece, it's something that we only implemented, I think, about a year and a half or a couple of years ago, which is before you open the doors of your business or before you go to market, create some core values for yourself. So create some non-negotiables, because again, you will be presented with crossroads in your journey, and you want to always ask yourself what you actually like. Don't just do something for the money. Don't do something because you think it's right. It has to align with the value. We set up our ones a while ago, which is abundance, empathy, balance, and collaboration. Collaboration's mainly based around the franchise arm, always working together as a team. Mm-hmm. And ever since we created those values, the amount of times I actually lean on those and outline them in an email to say, hey, this decision's based off XYZ because it aligns with who I am. And it doesn't need to be based around your business model. It needs to be based around you personally.
No, it's definitely a good point. I think it's bringing that personal side in, the human touch, if you like, mm-hmm. as well. Oh, and we do that a lot here too with the value system that's built at InXpress, and it is very valuable in that sense. All right, Tim, well, it looks like this parcel has been delivered, so thanks for your time.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate your time.
Good on you.
Bye.
I'm James Buck. Thank you for listening to Xpress Lane. Don't miss any of our small business insights by subscribing to the Xpress Lane podcast on your favourite podcast platform, or connect with InXpress Australia and New Zealand on Facebook and LinkedIn. And for anyone keen to join our global InXpress franchise network or to learn more about our services, visit our website, inxpress.com. Stay safe and catch you next time.